क्या आप आईएएस की तैयारी कर रहे हैं और कोचिंग इंस्टीट्यूट को 2.5 लाख तक की फीस नहीं पे करना चाहते? अगर हाँ तो 22,500 रुपए में घर बैठ के StudyIQ के पेनड्राइव कोर्स के साथ आप आईएएस की तैयारी कर सकते हैं। आज ही विजिट करें studyiq.com।
गुड मॉर्निंग एंड वेलकम टू StudyIQ। आई एम प्रशांत मावानी। आई होप यू आर डूइंग गुड दिस मॉर्निंग। जेके रोवलिंग, ऑथर ऑफ हैरी पॉटर, शी सेज दैट एनीथिंग्स पॉसिबल इफ यू हैव गॉट enough nerve. Think about this statement, right? If you are ready to invest that courage in the items or things that you are trying to achieve, then everything is available in this life. With this, the first editorial that we are going to analyze is Outbreak of Peace. It is about these two countries of Africa. We were talking about Africa a couple of days ago as well, because our Prime Minister was here in this continent, Africa, and here you can see these two countries here. One is Ethiopia and the other one is Eritrea. They are neighboring countries, and let me give you some basic details about Ethiopia and Eritrea before we move ahead. The capital is Addis Ababa of Ethiopia, and Eritrea's capital is Asmara. They are located at a very important geopolitical or strategic place. You can see here, this portion of Africa is called Horn of Africa. You have countries like Djibouti, you have Somalia, Ethiopia, Eritrea. There are other reasons as well why these countries are important. We will talk about it. But before that, let me give you a brief history, very brief history about these two countries. Ethiopia was ruling over this Eritrea after this guerrilla war. Finally, this Eritrea became an independent country. At present, they have this disputed area, as you can see on your screen. And one of the reasons why we find this item as an editorial in today's Hindu is because a couple of days ago, Ethiopia declared this thing that it is ready to implement a peace agreement that was signed between these two countries back in 2000, right? December 2000, in this city, Algiers, that is a capital of Algeria, a country that you find here that is sharing its border with Morocco. So it was in this country, this city, Algiers, that this peace agreement was signed. This peace agreement was brokered by African Union. African Union, just like European Union, it is a union of countries of Africa. Big difference between European Union and African Union is that all 55 countries that are part of this African continent are part of this African Union. In terms of some of the strongest country that we find in this continent are, you have Nigeria, you have Egypt, you have South Africa. These are some of the strongest countries that we find in this continent. Now, moving back to this editorial here, as I told you that this peace agreement was signed back in December 2000, and now Ethiopia has decided that they want to stop this problems that are going on between these two countries, particularly with this disputed area, for a very long period of time, because this conflict has caused very badly to both these countries here. Approximately 50,000 people have lost their lives because of this deadlock and because of this conflict. And one of the main reasons behind conflict is, as you can see here, you have two shades. One is blue and the other one is green. So the green portion here that you find predominantly on the border area between these two countries, this green portion is claimed by Ethiopia, but it is awarded to Eritrea. And then you have this blue portion that is claimed by Eritrea, but it is awarded to Ethiopia. The main bone of contention here is this town or city that is called Badem or Badmi, depending on various pronunciation. So this is a place here that has been a bone of contention between these two countries here. Now, the person that you can see on your screen, he is president of Eritrea. He is also a dictator. And what happens is that when you have this sort of conflicts going on, particularly if you are coming from African country, I'm not saying that all African countries follow this sort of dictator. They are under this sort of dictatorship, but most of the time this thing has been observed that a poor country, a country that is trying to meet its, you know, basic needs like food, water, other social amenities, and when you have presidents in this country, and particularly if you are having a sort of border issue just like this two countries here, then you find that for a very long period of time a particular person will hold important position, and most of the time they give out this reason that if there will be a change of guard, then this rival country will take over our land portion and it will be detrimental for our country, etc. So here something similar is happening in this Eritrea. And because of this prolonged confrontation, this president has expanded this conscription program. Conscription basically means that each and every single citizen, particularly men, they have to provide a service, right? They have to join army. They will be trained for a couple of years, and if it is required, then you will be asked to serve the army in this state of war, or if this country is in state of war with any country. As I told you, it is a very poor country, and it's not just Eritrea, right? Both these countries are one of the poorest nations of the world. And if you remember, I'm not sure if you all are, and how many of you are following current affairs from a very long period of time, but back in 2013, Eritrea was on global map because more than 300 people who were trying to escape this life of poverty, this life of dictatorship, you know, lack of food and lack of you can say a sustainable future for their younger generation, they decided that they will leave this country and they will head towards a developed continent, that is of course Europe. But unfortunately, the boat on which they were traveling, and this is just one case here, there are so many other cases coming from different African nations, particularly Saharan nations, right, that we find here in northern part of Africa. So many people, they do try to cross the Sahara, and they think that once they cross this Mediterranean Sea, they will reach Europe, and from there, in Europe, they will have a bright future. But that is not always the case, as you can see here, dead bodies. And Italy was very, very sad. This small island called Lampedusa, right? Lampedusa, that you find here, it is just in the southwestern part of Sicily. Sicily is again an island of Italy, and somewhere nearby this Lampedusa, this boat drowned, and more than 300 people passed away. You have this person on your screen. His name is Abiy Ahmed. He is popular as well as a young prime minister of Ethiopia. He is making some positive as well as radical change with this country of Ethiopia. He has decided to lift this state of emergency that was going on for a very long period of time. He has released thousands of political prisoners. He has removed some opposition parties from the list of terrorist groups as well. He is trying to make some, you know, he is trying to change the destiny as well as the present scenario of Ethiopia. But it's not all that easy in Ethiopia, because you have different communities, and clashes are going on between different communities as far as this political power is concerned. So there are internal tensions, and if this internal tensions will exacerbate, then this will create more troubles for this peace process, which is very important, because you can see so many people are losing their lives. It is one more thing that I would like to add here, that if you find conflict in any part of the world, I'll give you one example of our country itself. Back in somewhere around late 90s, in some parts of our northeast, right, there was this sort of conflicts between different communities, and because of this thing, so many kids, right, they lost their parents, and these kids were trafficked, and they were they were asked to they became victim of this human trafficking. Some of them are no more. Some of their organs were traded, and some of them are begging in different parts of the world. They are modern slaves now because of this conflict. So conflict is not good for any society, and it applies to this Ethiopia as well as this country, or when we talk about these two neighboring countries of Horn of Africa. Now, I was going to explain you this thing, that why these two countries are important, why their location is very important, because you can see here, I'll take you through this map. You can see Red Sea here, it is sharing its border. Of course, Ethiopia is a landlocked country, so for Ethiopia, connectivity to sea is through Djibouti. But if the relationship between this Eritrea and this Ethiopia gets all right, then they can have access to Red Sea via Eritrea as well. Then you can see Red Sea here, Gulf of Aden is here. So if you want to enter or exit Arabian Sea, or from Mediterranean Sea, if you want to enter or exit this Arabian Sea or Indian Ocean, then you have to pass through this portion here. And I have got a question here as well. Can you give me the name of this small strait that you find here? What is the name of this portion, this strait? It's a very important and very famous strait as well. Apart from that, you know that Djibouti, we were talking about Djibouti a couple of days ago. I told you that military base of China, and then you have France, you have Japan, you have USA, they have built their military base over here. So in this way, and as far as this counter-terrorism is concerned, issues are going on in Yemen, issues are going on in this part, Somalia. Terrorism and piracy and other things are prevalent over here. So location of these two countries are important in this context. With this second item that we have is up and away. It is about stock exchange or stock indices. At present, Nifty and Sensex, they have touched their record high. And I'll give you one example, a very basic example, right? It's not technical, but it will help you with, of course, it's not 100% mythical, but it will help you with how it works. So just imagine that you have purchased a stock, right? You have got two shares. One is listed in Nifty and the other one is listed in Sensex. Now, as you know that at present they have touched this 37,300 point, and Nifty has touched 11,200 point. So if you have purchased a share, for example, share named A, and then you have purchased a share named B from Sensex, and that is listed in Sensex and the other one is listed in Nifty. If you have purchased it for 11,200 rupees, just for example, and Nifty is also clocking at 11,200 at present, and Sensex share number B, you have got it at 37,300 rupees. Now imagine after a couple of months, if Nifty is somewhere around 12,000 and this one, the Sensex, is say 40,000, then of course the price of your, or the value of your share will go up. This is how it works. It's very basic, very layman's language, right? But it's just a small example here. But the thing that we have to take into consideration here is that when we say Nifty and Sensex, they are roaring again, or if they have crossed the new high, that means record high, then it does not mean that everything is going all right with our Nifty and Sensex. If we observe the stocks that we have, then we find that only those heavyweights, those blue chip companies, right? Blue chip means big companies. Their stock is doing very well. And one of the main reason is confidence in this foreign institutional investors. Huge amount of investment is coming from this FIIs. And because of this thing, this Nifty and Sensex has crossed, or they are roaring again. But if we go and check the other small companies, then we find that their position is not that good. In fact, they are not performing that well. So it is you cannot say that it is a balanced rise of Nifty and Sensex. That's everything that we can analyze in this editorial. From this editorial, that's everything that we can learn. If you are interested in stock market, then of course you will be aware about more things. Then it's not just about FIIs, it is more than that. It is about sentiments as well, how the people who are associated with those stakeholders what's the vibe that they are feeling. If they are feeling positive, then it can go up. And even if ground reality is good, but if sentiments are not good, then stock markets and stock can come down. Third item that we have is this, and it is, and it will subside. It is about a writer, a Malayalam writer. His name is Ash Harish, as you can see on your screen. He is smiling here, but he is going through a very bad phase at present. See, this writers or this novelist, they use dialogue, right? Dialogue as a tool. And dialogue is, person one saying a line, then person two is replying to that line. Many a times they are talking about a third party, and something similar took place in this novel of S. Harish. The name of this novel is Misha, and it means mustache. So why it is in controversy? This two characters in this novel, they are talking about a woman, or they are talking about women in general who visit temples on regular basis. Now, you know things that are going on in Kerala at present, and because of this thing, there are so many people out there, right? They have started using abusive language. They have started releasing these threats for this S. Harish as well as his family members. And trolling is such a new, as well as it's a very negative thing as well. It indicates a negative bent of our people too, right? Trolling is, if you are logical enough, means most of the time we find that there are so many people out there, they write anything that the thing is right, right? They use abusive language, they compare people with negative things. This sort of things may look simple to them. They can write anything they like, but the problem is it will create a psychological scar on the person on whom this trolling is executed. The other thing is issuing threats of life for the our writers. We have seen something similar with many films as well. And if we go and check our constitution, then we find that our constitution allows all of us, right? We have to be limited. We have to be careful about what we are saying. We cannot hurt someone. We cannot use abusive language and things like that. But you have this freedom of expression, and you have different tools. Like you can make films. You can write short stories or novels or letters. You can issue speeches and other things. And nowadays we have social media that has empowered every one of us. But that does not mean that we misuse social media. And the reason why we are discussing this thing is because if you analyze this topic, then you find that it is touching so many different, it is touching so many different strings of this cobweb of our society. You have constitution on one side, then you have this freedom of speech. You have this social media and its role in empowering our society. At the same time, you can also think about negative or side effects or demerits of social media. Then we have these cases going on, and how this vested group, some people out there, they are trying to spread this hatred in our society, and this is not right. One more thing that you can add on, or that can be a point of analysis or food for thought, is our judicial process. Why this sort of things are going on? How can one issue threats, this sort of threats, and they can enjoy freedom? They should be kept behind the bars, isn't it? Because it is illegal if you are issuing threats to someone or someone's family. You can imagine the pressure through which this gentleman is going. He has decided that he is not going to write this novel anymore. But this is again a breach of our freedom of speech, as well as he has also said that our judicial process are tiring for common man, and he is right as well. It will take ages for him if he is taking a few people out there or a few organizations who are issuing this sort of threats. Then it will take ages for him to get justice. So we have to work on many different levels if we want to see this freedom of speech to flourish in our society. Now we have this article here. I have gone through this article. You can completely drop it if you like, if you are interested in politics. When I say politics, I'm not talking about polity, constitution and governance. I'm talking about future of BJP and future of Congress and other parties. So if you are interested in this sort of things, there is no harm in it as well. Then you can help yourself with it. You can go through it. It is more about future of BJP and what it is doing and what Congress is doing and things like that. But as far as your exams are concerned, this article is not important. Now, today is Saturday, and I'm sure you all are aware about this thing that now I do analyze the Hindu, Hindi as well. The Hindu analysis in Hindi is analyzed by me, is delivered by me. So, because Hindi students, they find it a bit difficult to comprehend this articles, right? So, earlier on, we hardly used to take this Saturday article, this Ground Zero. But I have analyzed it, so I thought let me share this thing with you as well. But as we have less articles, that does not mean that we are going to end this discussion very soon. I have got one add-on article as well, right? It is coming from different source. You'll not find it in Hindu, but let's go through this kayaking. The small picture that you can see, it's a small boat. When I say boat, it's the proper name of this boat is canoe. And the sport that is associated with this canoe is called canoeing as well, and it is a thing called kayaking. Now there is a small place in Kerala, Kodancherry, and Kodancherry was not that famous as it is now. If you go back 6 years ago, then you find that it was not famous at all, but now you find world players are coming here. You find European champions dining in a small, you can say that dhaba type, you know, restaurants that we have, small restaurants. You find people like European champion and New Zealand champion, and you find other people, American, this kayaks producers are here. And one of the reason is it was all started by few Indians, right? Couple of years ago, when they first visited this place, they started using these kayaks, and the people of this town, they were surprised. They were a bit afraid of what these gentlemen were doing. They in fact tried to warn them as well that the current of the river is very strong, so you may lose your life. So many other people have lost their lives and things like that. But very quickly, these villagers, they realized that these guys, they know what they are doing. They are professionals in what they are doing, and it became a very famous water sport destination. And this also indicates that we have huge amount of potential in our country as far as tourism is concerned. And we have rivers, and we have so many mountains, so you can have this kite flying, and you can have this water sports, mountain sports, other sort of adventure sports. We have immense potential in our country. There are so many pockets out there that can be explored and that can be kept at world platform. For this, our civil servants, right, working at various different levels, they have to keep their eyes and ears open. Most of the time, they are the ones who are decision makers, and they can, means, you know, they have access to they interact with delegates from foreign countries. They do travel as well. Of course, there are people in our country as citizens as well. We can contribute, and we can contribute. We can pass this idea to government. But the main responsibility here is of civil servants. So they should keep their eyes and ears open for this sort of opportunities that we have. Because if we compare our tourism sector, if we just compare it with a small tiny country called Singapore, then you find that the number of tourists visiting Singapore is more than tourists visiting our country. So here you go. You know that it is a sort of unexplored territory, India, as far as this world community is concerned. The other thing is tourism is a sector that can create organized jobs, or jobs in organized sector. Make in India manufacturing is a good thing. It's not a bad idea, right? We need to promote our manufacturing as well. But if we want to create jobs for our youngsters, proper jobs in organized sector, then tourism, which is of course part of service sector, it has immense potential. It can create so many jobs. And if you invest, say, 100 rupees in manufacturing, and if you invest 100 rupees in tourism, I'm just giving you a rough example. Then over here, you can create one job, but over here, you can create 9 jobs based on various different analysis. Apart from that, this whole article is about Western Ghat, a place in Western Ghat. So let me give you a brief about our Western Ghat. You can see here, it starts from Gujarat, then it passes through Maharashtra, Goa, you have Karnataka, Kerala, and Tamil Nadu. So 6 states are there when we talk about Western Ghat, and it is a biodiversity hotspot of our country, of the world, and it is also termed as hottest biodiversity hotspot of the world. With this, we have this extra, or you can say add-on editorial. It is about life in another planet. Of course, it's a big mystery. NASA's Curiosity rover has been roving over this Mars for a very long period of time now. And we also know this thing that the place on which it is roving over, it is on this dried up lakes that used to be on Mars. But a very interesting observation or very interesting fact has been observed by this European Space Agency's Mars Express Orbiter. It has detected a sizable body of liquid water under the ice cap of the South Pole of Mars. The picture that you can see here, this is the South Pole of this planet Mars. And as per this Mars Express Orbiter, somewhere around 1.5 kilometer beneath this ice, we have liquid water available on Mars. So a big mystery. It's a very interesting thing for astrobiology and people associated with this subject, and now we have to, right? In future, we will find out whether we have any form of life on Mars or whether it is possible to have a life on Mars. We have to wait and watch for it. We need to send a separate mission for this one. When I say we, I mean to say humanity, and we have to drill this 1.5 kilometer deep, you know, a bore or something. So it's going to take time and a huge amount of investment and expertise. So I believe this is a very important information for humanity. It's a big thing. If you look at it from where we used to be in caves, and now we are talking about another planet. So it's a big thing. Now we have news items. On front page, you will find this this B.N. Krishna committee's report that is delivered now. Now government will go through it, and it talks about what is, it explains various different things, like what is personal data. Data relating to a natural person. When we say a person, many a times, you know, firms and companies and organizations, they are also taken as a person. Here we are not talking about a human being. We are talking about as a person. You know, if a company or a firm is polluting environment, then that firm is taken as, and that entity is taken as a person. But here, when we say natural person, we are talking about human beings. So information associated with human beings are part of this personal data. A right to be forgotten. That means if you want to delete your information, if you want these companies to delete your information, then you will be bestowed with this sort of rights as well. There are other key recommendations, like personal data shall be processed only for the purposes that are clearly specified in the contract, and all firms will have to have one data protection officer. If you have any issues, then you can directly contact the data officer. Then central government shall notify Data Protection Authority of India. Firms will have to ensure that at least one copy of personal data, foreign companies, right, they have to store their one copy in India. Critical personal data shall not be processed in server or data center located in India, and you cannot take data outside. Some datas that are very important associated with health and some other things. It also provides explanation on what is sensitive personal data, like your sex life, sexual orientation, biometric data, genetic data, transgender status, and then your financial data, health data, etc. Personal data breach has been explained here. Processing of personal data, profiling, all these things are explained, and there are provisions for recommendations for penalties as well. So it's a very holistic, you can say, recommendations coming from this B.N. Krishna committee. I'm sure we will find some editorials and articles on this item. Apart from that, European Union is not happy with this park elections because many political parties and leaders were not allowed to freely campaign. And, you know, this rigging has taken place and military was very much involved in this general as well as provincial election. Their main aim, as per various reports, it looks that army wants to get rid of this Sharif family, that is Nawaz Sharif, and his brother was chief minister of one of the strongest and economically prosperous state of Pakistan, that is Punjab. Mr. Modi had a bilateral meeting with Ramaphosa is head of South Africa. And this is how it works, right? When we have this big summits, on the sidelines of big summits, we do conduct this in diplomatic world. This is how it works, that you do arrange this bilateral meetings as well. And we have a very good example of Mr. Modi and Mr. Xi Jinping. They had a bilateral meeting with each other and they have decided that they are going to work to make sure that work together and on individual capacity to make sure that peace and tranquility is maintained in our border area. Supreme Court is not happy with central government and various state governments because there are four posts vacant in CIC despite a government advertisement issued in 2016. And there are other state information commissions where you find vacant posts. So this is not healthy. Good news for India that World Meteorological Organization WMO has designated India as a nodal center for preparing flash flood forecasts, and this will be helpful for Vietnam, Sri Lanka, Myanmar, Thailand. You know, recently we were talking about this country called Laos, how a dam bursted and it has killed, if I'm not wrong, 125 plus people. We are going to use this flash flood guidance system, and the main aim here is to provide forecast 6 hours in advance. NGT has raised red flags as far as this pollution in Ganga is concerned, and if we go through this facts here, this numbers here, then we find that number of professors as well as professionals and teachers in higher education, in higher educational institutions of our country, the numbers are dropping down, which is a matter of concern. Again, a small picture on Pakistan. Help yourself with this one. These are your answers. Both the statements are right. This map is or this country that you can see is Taiwan, and it was in news because of this few airlines. They termed or they were calling Taiwan as a part of China, and you can see here two flags. This one is a left one, and this one is a right flag on your screen. Now, can you tell me which flag belongs to which country? To help you, let me tell you that one of the flag is belonging to this country, Australia. Let me give you a brief about Australia. Australia has six big states: Western Australia, Northern Territory, Queensland, South Australia, New South Wales, and Victoria. You will find that Australia's capital is Canberra. Most of the time people confuse it with Sydney. Sydney is not the capital. It's a big city, of course, a very famous city. Most of the cities of Australia are located on this shore here. Then you find a couple of cities here, Darwin and Perth and Adelaide. Tasmania is an island of Australia. Don't confuse it with Tanzania. And you can see Tropic of Capricorn is passing from approx right in the middle from Australia, dividing Australia into two different parts. But I'm not saying that exactly in the middle, it's approximately right. And you can see on the eastern side it has got the Pacific Ocean, and on the western side it has got Indian Ocean, and Great Barrier Reef is a maritime diversity place that is located in the shores of Australia. These are your two new questions. That's everything in today's discussion. Thank you very much for your love and support. I'll see you tomorrow. Tomorrow is Sunday. I'll see you tomorrow. Enjoy your day. Jai Hind.